we thought we might take a look back at the Sam Raimi Spider-Man films. In hindsight, there's something refreshingly intimate about the stakes of Sam Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy. Raimi's three films are built around a fairly simple question. Will Peter Parker become a good man? Historically, superhero comics have been aimed at a young male audience. There's some truth in the oft-repeated cliché that superheroes are soap operas for boys. It's easy to see this target market reflected in the familiar tropes of the genre. As with many young adult heroes, from Frodo Baggins through to Harry Potter, a lot of the classic superheroes are orphans. Stan Lee has his own theories about why this is the case.
The writers are too lazy to dream up a background to them.
However, it seems just as likely that making these characters orphans captures that sense of freedom for which many teenagers yearn. That's to say nothing of the theme of body transformation that runs through superhero comics, which undoubtedly resonates with teenagers going through their own process of body transformation.
Change? Yeah. Big change.
The original Spider-Man comics written by Stan Lee and illustrated by Steve Ditko tapped into this, focusing on a teen protagonist, balancing the demands of catching criminals and helping his kindly Aunt May to pay the bills. Stan Lee argued that Spider-Man was probably the first comic book hero that teenagers themselves could identify with. The fact that Peter was allowed to grow up was part of this. Peter actually aged over the first few years of the comic, first graduating from high school, and then going to college. This is very much the arc of Sam Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy. As ever, Uncle Ben is helpfully on hand to provide thematic exposition.
These are the years when a man changes into the man he's going to become the rest of his life. Just be careful who you change into.
Of course, that idea of transformation is rather more literal in the case of a teenager who's just been bitten by a radioactive spider. As he tries to come to terms with his powers, Peter's moral transgressions are small. He beats up a bully at school. He uses his powers to win a wrestling match to earn some money to buy a car to impress Mary Jane. And there's also some light homophobia.
That's a cute outfit. Did your husband give it to you?
Although Spider-Man 3 somehow complicates matters with an unnecessary retcon, Peter's worst decision is one of inaction, allowing a thief to escape when he could easily have stopped him.
I missed the part where that's my problem.
None of these are unforgivable. None of these are particularly epic in scope. This tension continues through the films that follow, even after Peter commits to wearing the blue and red leotard.
Looks uncomfortable.
It rides up in the crotch a little bit.
Spider-Man 2 finds Peter desperate to shrug off the responsibility that he's assumed, to return to a life of passivity and inaction.
Am I not supposed to have what I want? What I need?
It's a fair question, and an earnest one. Let's pause here to acknowledge that Mary Jane is starring in a production of The Importance of Being Earnest, almost as if Sam Raimi is trying to tell us something. Raimi's Spider-Man movie suggests that being a good person takes work. It's a constant effort, rather than a simple defined goal. In this sense, it's interesting to contrast the questions of morality that run through Sam Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy with a lot of the more modern superhero genre. So many modern superhero films are built around the idea of the power fantasy. The idea that having access to that sort of power is thrilling and intoxicating, rather than something that requires introspection and reflection. To mangle an original and profound quote, "With great power comes great responsibility." Many modern blockbusters weave moral ambiguity into their storytelling, suggesting that these characters are not as heroic as they might appear. In Batman Begins, Bruce Wayne leaves Ra's al Ghul to die on a train. In Age of Ultron, Tony Stark builds an omnicidal robot in his own image that almost destroys mankind. Even in Spider-Man Far From Home, Peter Parker wears a suit with a kill mode and commands a fleet of tactical drones.
Activating instant kill.
No, I don't want to kill anybody.
Deactivating instant kill.
However, as with so much else in modern superhero movies, the scale is often blown way out of proportion. This might also reflect the extent to which modern pop culture has abandoned earnestness for detached irony. The only moral transgressions worth measuring are those with a body count. Sam Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy seems achingly sincere in its question of whether Peter Parker will be a good person, acknowledging that his moral failings are more relatable and more low stakes than the drama that we've come to expect from the genre. Raimi explicitly genders the question of whether Peter will be a good man. Despite the film's bright, wholesome, technicolor aesthetic, which looks like something out of West Side Story, there's a surprising amount of adult sexuality at play in Raimi's Spider-Man films, particularly in contrast to the modern sexless blockbuster. That sexuality is present in the implied sexual violence and the wet t-shirt before the iconic upside-down kiss. It's also present in Peter's sticky hands during his transformation. And yes, even in Harry Osborn's enthusiasm in eating pie.
So good.
As such, it's notable that one of the key measures of Peter's goodness throughout the trilogy is his behavior towards Mary Jane and the other women in his life. Mary Jane is treated terribly by the men around her, In a shouting match barely heard, her father tells her that she's as stupid as her mother. Her boyfriend Flash tells her not to scratch the leather on the sports car that he got for his birthday. Harry's father Norman is even more explicit about how his son should treat Mary Jane.
A word to the not so wise about your little girlfriend. Do what you need to with her, then broom her fast.
Of course, Norman is secretly the villainous Green Goblin, despite his penchant for disguise. But it's telling that his villainy manifests through a bitter strain of misogyny. In this context, it's notable that Norman ends up symbolically castrated by his own glider. Now, an innocent observer might reflect that this just makes it easier for Willem Dafoe to collapse on top of the glider when he dies. But hey, who are we to avoid cheap symbolism when it comes our way?
The night your father died, I cleaned his wound. The blade that pierced his body came from his glider.
This theme even plays through the horribly disjointed and uneven Spider-Man 3. One of the more controversial aspects of the film concerns Peter's possession by the Venom symbiote, an alien lifeform designed to bring out the worst in its host. In comics, the symbiote was a product of the late 1980s, an era known for its unnecessary brutality and hyper-violence. In Spider-Man 3, the symbiote seems to convince Peter to restyle his hair, strut down the street to James Brown, and generally be a bit of a jerk. That said, the suit does make Peter genuinely unpleasant to the women in his life. He toys with the affection that Ursula, the daughter of his landlord, has for him. When Mary Jane breaks up with him, he takes the beautiful Gwen Stacy to the nightclub where she works to show her up, a grotesque spectacle that humiliates both Gwen and Mary Jane. Gwen is clearly hurt by the fact that Peter would use her in such a passive-aggressive manner to attack Mary Jane. This is a far pettier act of villainy than allowing supervillains to die, designing killer robots, or ordering target drone strikes on your romantic rival. However, it is a moral failure that is recognizable and relatable to an audience watching. Kirk Connors makes the point that the symbiont
amplifies characteristics of its host.
This spiteful and self-centered version of Peter was inside him all the time. After all, Peter cheated on Mary Jane by kissing Gwen in public before he encountered the symbiont. As with the earlier films in the series, Spider-Man 3 returns to the boundary between being a good man and a bad guy. Peter is juxtaposed with Eddie Brock, a similar young hotshot photographer, who's largely defined by his creepy behavior towards Gwen.
What about that amazing, amazing night that we had?
We had coffee.
Even Flint Marko, the Sandman, finds himself confronted by his failure as a husband and father.
And that is the truth that you left behind, right there in that bedroom.
Many modern superhero movies operate at a level of spectacle that puts millions, if not billions, of lives at risk. This includes the devastation wrought in later Spider-Man movies, like The Amazing Spider-Man, or Homecoming, or Far From Home. The stakes are often so impossibly large that they become alien and abstract. If one death is a tragedy, sometimes a million is just empty computer-generated spectacle. Sam Raimi's Spider-Man movies relied on something more grounded, even as its hero swung between skyscrapers. It explored what it means to be a good man, whether spider or otherwise. I've been Darren Mooney, and this was In the Frame.